Today we have one of the most famous people here at the University of Texas, actually in the entire world. We have David Buss. David Buss is really one of the founders of the field of evolutionary psychology, and it's a joy to have you here. Welcome.
Thank you. Great to be here chatting with you.
So what is all this stuff about evolutionary psychology? What does it have to say about the nature of human existence? What does it have to say about love and hate and war and peace?
Well, basically, what it says is evolutionary psychology is looking at the human mind through the lens of evolutionary theory, and it focuses on what are the adaptive problems our ancestors had to solve, and what are the adaptive solutions, what are our psychological mechanisms that we carry with us today that have been successful in solving those problems. We saw a few earlier having to do with infants and their survival problems, but when you get to adulthood, you face a different set of problems, and those involve mating. So you can survive to be 150 years old, but if you don't successfully mate, then basically you bite the evolutionary dust, genetically speaking. And so the field of evolutionary psychology tends to focus on those things that are highly relevant to reproductive success. So survival problems and mating problems are absolutely critical.
So how do you study this in the laboratory? And what would be some questions that would be of interest?
Well, we study it basically by generating hypotheses about the nature of our psychological mechanisms and whether humans possess design features on their psychological mechanisms that solve those specific adaptive problems. So, for example, in the jealousy case, because fertilization occurs internally within the female, not within the male, males face this adaptive problem, the problem of paternity uncertainty. No woman has ever faced this. Some cultures actually have a wonderful phrase to describe this. They say, mama's baby, papa's maybe. That kind of captures that asymmetry. And so we expect the design, the psychological design of jealousy, to be somewhat differently configured in men and women because they face different threats.
Mm-hmm. Now, does evolutionary psychology speak to who we're attracted to? For example, I've noticed that all women find me absolutely irresistible.
Right. Actually, it does, and that's a bias that some men have.
No.
It's called the sexual overperception bias, and we studied this in a laboratory where we bring people in, and it's kind of like a speed dating situation where they interact with several people for several minutes, and then right after their interactions, they say, "Do you think that person was sexually interested in you?" And then we also ask, "Were you sexually interested in that person?" And what we find is that men display this very consistent sexual overperception bias. A woman smiles at a man, they think, "Oh, she wants me." So this sexual overperception bias, though, I think is very important because it leads to some very unwanted consequences, like unwanted sexual advances, possibly even sexual harassment. And so I think it's very important to understand male and female minds. We have a different sexual psychology, and so knowledge about these biases, I think, might be helpful in overcoming things like unwanted sexual advances and sexual harassment.
Now, is this related at all to stalking?
It is related to stalking because many stalkers carry with them false beliefs. That is, they think the woman really does love them, that she's just testing the strength of his love, or that she would love him if only she got to know him. So it is related to stalking. Unfortunately, stalking is a very pervasive phenomenon. It's illegal. I don't recommend it. And it's especially dangerous to women because men tend to be stalkers and they tend to be more violent when they are stalkers.
So you've got a website that deals with this, right?
Yes. We developed a website. It's called stalkinghelp.org, and it's a website specifically designed to help victims of stalking. Mm-hmm. So if you think that you've been a victim of stalking, go to stalkinghelp.org, and there's a lot of information about legal issues, things that you can do to try to deal with this problem of stalking.
Now,
we have a question here from Scott who wants to know, how does evolutionary psychology understand gay people? Because presumably they would not pass on their genes and bite the evolutionary dust.
Yes, and in fact, that's been called the Darwinian paradox. And I wish I could tell you that we knew the answer, but we don't at this point. It's looking like a number of different causal variables are contributing to it, and there's not one big cause of sexual orientation.
One more thing I wanted to ask. I know that you've looked at mating and love and so forth, but you've got a dark side. I've sometimes noticed that you also look at who murders who. How is that relevant to evolutionary psychology?
Yes, I have looked at murder. Mating and murder, basically, are the two things that I focus on.
But,
and they're related, because most of the motives for murder turn out to be related to mating. But you can understand it basically by the logic, by evolutionary logic, which occurs by differential reproductive success. So there are basically two ways to get ahead in the world in terms of reproductive success. You can do things that enhance your reproductive success, attract a mate and so forth, or you could do things that decrease the success of your rivals. And one sure way to decrease the success of your rivals is to kill them. Mm-hmm. And so that's an extreme case, and fortunately we have laws against it. But over human evolutionary history, murder has been a very powerful force because it has such dramatic consequences for fitness and reproductive success.
Very interesting. So who do we murder?
Mostly it's men murdering other men, and it's murdering their rivals. So they murder over things like social status, they murder over resources, and they murder to acquire resources so that they can be more attractive on the mating market. Mm-hmm. Historically, also, there's small group warfare in traditional societies where the primary cause of the murder is to obtain women.
Oh, very cool.
A very valuable reproductive resource.
We have a question here from Travis asking, how do you do your studies? How do you study this in the lab?
Well, we use basically all the methods that psychology uses. So we use laboratory studies, questionnaire methodologies. But we also use other methods. So there, for example, is the paleo archaeological evidence. We have stones and bones. So we can know, for example, that homicides did occur thousands and thousands of years ago, because we find people who have injuries to their skeletons and skulls that correspond in shape and size to the weapons found at the time. And there are mass graves, in fact, that demonstrate this. So warfare and murder have been part of human evolutionary history. But evolutionary psychology uses all the methods of psychology and then some additional ones as well. And now one new method that's coming into play is molecular genetics. So with increased sophistication with molecular genetics technology, we're able to test certain evolutionary hypotheses in those ways as well.
Very interesting. So David, what undergraduate classes do you teach here at UT?
I teach two. I teach one in evolutionary psychology, and then I teach a second in psychology of human mating.
Okay. I should say that David's classes are very highly subscribed. He's a wonderful teacher, as you can imagine, and is doing work that's just fabulous. Thank you so much for visiting.
Thank you. That's been a wonderful talk.